So let us start from where we have left the last class. Last class we have studied about potential energy and electrostatic potential. Stop talking. Okay. Close your phone. Phone should not be given to you actually. It is not required. And if it is, then Nokia, that first, that phone comes, right? Still looking at phone. Okay, so we'll start a fresh topic now. Alright? This topic is the capacitors. Alright? So we are going to discuss the last part of the electrostatics. Fine? And this is probably the most important part of electrostatics, because question on if it is pure electrostatics question, it will be probably based on capacitors. Okay, because mechanics, very difficult to mix mechanics with the capacitors. Okay, so before we even start talking about capacitors, we need to first understand about dielectrics. Fine, we had a brief introduction about the metals, how metal behave in the electric field. Yes or no? How it behaves? Inside the metal electric field is what?
Constant.
Constant or zero? It is zero. It is zero. Right? So suppose you have a metal. Suppose this is a metal piece. Okay? Now there is an external electric field, it comes like this. What will happen to this external electric field? Because of this external electric field, there will be negative charges over here induced and positive charges will be induced there. Yes or no? Right? Now these negative and positive charges will induce electric field in which direction? Their own electric field. Will be like this. This electric field is because of this positive and negative. Okay? And why this is created? Because negative charge is this way and positive charge is that way. And why negative is here? Because the electrons, the free electrons in the metal, gets attracted opposite direction to the external electric field. Yes or no? Right? Now there is, suppose one free electron over here. One free electron is over here. It will experience net electric field of what? This electric field minus that electric field. E internal. Find this electron which is available here will experience E external minus E internal. Yes or no? Right? And then what will happen? The electron will come over here, so this negative charge will increase, the positive charge will also increase, and this internal electric field will also increase. So it will keep on increasing till the free electron experiences no force. And when free electron will not experience any force, when net electric field will become zero. Okay, so inside the metal, net electric field will be zero. It happens instantaneously, you can say. Fine. Now, metal is a special kind of material, you can say. It has free electron, it behaves in a very special manner. Okay, immediately make sure that electric field becomes zero inside it. Fine. But apart from metals, there are different kinds of material. Okay, so in general, we call these material as dielectrics. Fine. And in fact, since we have already studied about the metals, we say that dielectric is an insulator. Fine. So what is the property of insulator? It doesn't have free electrons. It doesn't have free electron, right? But does it have electron?
Yeah.
It has electron. It has nucleus. So will the electron get affected by the external electric field or not?
No.
No.
Are you sure? It should get affected, right? But will it be able to move?
No.
When I say movement, what kind of movement I am saying? Jumping from one atom to other atom, that is not possible. But at least it can stretch itself. For example, if this is nucleus and this is electron cloud, if you apply electric field like this, it will get distorted. It will be like this. The electron will not leave the nucleus, but it will become a dipole. Getting it? So in a dielectric, when you expose a dielectric to external electric field, a dipole gets created. Fine? And there can be millions, zillions of dipoles get created because of the exposure to the electric field. But then this electron cannot leave the nucleus and go away. Fine? So when I say study of dielectric, we are going to study this kind of behavior. We already studied the metallic behavior. Fine? Why we are doing it? Because in capacitors, the use of dielectric is very common. So that is why we are studying the dielectric first. Write down dielectric. In external field. Fine. So here is a piece of dielectric. You are applying an external, let's say, uniform electric field. This is external field. Because of this external field, dipoles will get generated. Just now we have discussed what kind of dipoles it will be. It will be as if negative charge is here, positive charge is here. So there will be so many such dipoles that will get created. Many of them like this throughout the volume. Getting it? Right? Let's draw a couple of them over here as well. All of you draw it. Fine. And in the blackboard, sorry, in the whiteboard, you may see that I am able to draw only one plane. This could be like a cube. Dipoles are there in entire volume. Okay? So immediately after this dipole, there will be another dipole. Now that dipole might be overlapping this dipole like this. It will have negative here, positive there. Getting it? Understood my point? Okay. So this negative positive, since they overlap, you can treat them as if it gets neutralized. Fine. So similarly, next to it, there will be minus plus. This gets neutralized. So all of them will get neutralized. Okay. So this will get neutralized. This will also get neutralized. Only the positive at this end will not be neutralized, and negative that end will not be neutralized. Understood? Right. So this entire scenario. Okay. What I was saying was that suppose one dipole gets created like this minus plus. Okay. There can be another dipole right after this on top of this. Slightly above it, who will be minus here and plus here. So this minus and plus, since it overlaps, you can say that it gets nullified. Fine. So that is what we are going to study. So this entire dielectric will be treated as if what? As if there are some negative charges over here and some positive charges over there. Fine? Any doubts? Okay, so this negative charge is not because of the free electrons moving. This is because of the dipole. Okay? Now, is this behavior similar to metal? Is it similar to metal?
Yeah.
Right? But what will be the difference? The field, because of this internal one, let's call it as E internal and this is E external, this may not be perfectly cancelling the external electric field. That's the only difference. Internal electric field is weaker than external in an insulator. Understood? Okay? In case of metal, you had so many free electrons, even if it gets lighter to the force, it moves and tries to cancel out the external electric field. But here, since these charges are fixed succeed completely. Fine. Now, the strength of internal electric field depends on what? This depends on what? Does it depend on external electric field?
Yeah.
It should depend on it, right? More number of dipoles will get created if external electric field is strong.
Yeah.
Right? Now, will it depend on the material also?
Yes.
It depends on the material, right? Now, if I want to find out the material property based on external and internal, what should I do? You understand what I am trying to say? I am trying to find what is the property which only depends on material. Because internal electric field depends on external electric field also. So what property will not, which parameter doesn't depend on the external electric field but only on the material? No, in terms of these two.
External
electric field divided by internal electric field. Amount of internal electric field created, sorry, amount of external field per unit internal electric field will be independent of external electric field. So if you double the external electric field, even internal will also double. Are you getting it? So ratio becomes constant. Are you getting the point? So if you increase the external electric field, proportionately internal electric field also increases. But the ratio remains constant. Fine. So this ratio is independent of external electric field. Can I say this?
Yes.
And it only depends on material, right? Yeah. So we use this ratio to define the dielectric. We say that this ratio is a dielectric constant, which is K. Fine. Amount of external electric field per unit electric field is the dielectric constant. Any doubts till now? Anything?
Sir, it is independent of what?
Independent of external electric field.
Is the same dielectric constant used in the Coulomb's law when they say charges are inside a material, a certain material, when they force attraction and repulsion?
Inside the material, inside some other material, their force decreases.
There are questions in which, like, the charges are placed inside water and dielectric constant of water is given as
A. So force become F by 8. Because electric field reduces, na? You can see this will reduce the external electric field. So water will reduce the external electric field, so force reduces. Fine, so water is a dielectric.
Huh? This also depends on the size of the material.
No. It only depends on what is the material. Getting it? Number of dipoles gets created depends on the size of the material. Number of dipoles. Okay? But if size increases, then the amount of dipole per meter cube remains same. Yes or no? Right? Density remains same. All of you understood the definition of dielectric constant?
Yes.
Understood? Okay, good. Now, let us say that the charge density over here is sigma p. We say that this is the charge due to polarization of the dielectric. Fine? We say that this is charge due to the polarization. Okay? Treat this as if this is an infinite sheet of charge, this line, and try to find out sigma p in terms of k and external electric field. Can you find out sigma p in terms of k and external electric field? What is the electric field due to a sheet of charge? You remember? Sigma by 2 epsilon naught. Sigma by 2 epsilon naught.
sigma by 2 up here.
K sigma by
2 up here.
No. Should I solve? Okay, tell me what will be the value of E internal. This should be what? Equal to? In terms of sigma.
Sigma into surface area.
Due to this, electric field is sigma by 2 epsilon naught. Due to that, again sigma by 2 epsilon naught in the same direction. So total electric field is sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught. Sigma divided by epsilon naught, sorry. This is internal electric field. But internal electric field is not given. External is given.
So E internal equals K by E external.
This should be equal to what?
Oh, K by E external.
E external
by K.
K sigma by.
So sigma P is epsilon naught E external divided by K. Okay, just I think there is a small error. Correction, guys. It's a correction. Dielectric constant is E electric field without dielectric and electric field with dielectric. This is net electric field. This is electric field without dielectric and this is with dielectric. Understood? Okay. Dielectric is this, no? Beta. The with dielectric, what is the electric field? E minus E internal. This is what is in the denominator. Fine? So this is how dielectric constant is defined. So this is just a definition. So the way it is defined is like this, not the way we have just
put it. E not is the field.
E is the, suppose there is a place. Okay? Electric field will be E without dielectric. Now I am putting a material. Electric will be changed. So denominator is that. Changed electric field is the denominator and without dielectric, what was the electric field? That is in the numerator. Understood? Without dielectric field divided by with dielectric. Both are net electric field. So small correction, okay? Now tell me what is sigma P. Defining the earlier way was also fine, there was no problem with that. But then the way everybody has agreed to define dielectric constant is like this. Okay? So, let's try to use that. Anybody got? Electric field with dielectric is external electric field minus internal electric field.
So sigma into 2 sigma into epsilon.
So E minus E, this is equal to K. Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. So E internal becomes what? E is equal to K times E minus K times E internal. So internal electric field will be equal to E 1 minus 1 by K. Any doubt? Yes or no? This is equal to what? Sigma by epsilon naught, sigma p is epsilon naught e into 1 minus 1 by k. Mathematics. Okay.
So it is 1 minus k.
Do the mathematics. Okay, any doubts? This chapter is done in school?
No.
I think I have asked this third time. So teacher has gone for your evaluation. Came back, started teaching.
Gossip.
Okay, now let us start the topic which we are waiting for. Capacitors. Write down. Capacitors, or it is also referred at times as capacitance. Okay. So capacitor is a device, write down, capacitor is a device which stores the charge or electrostatic potential energy. Fine. It is a device to store the charge or electrostatic potential energy. Okay? Just like you have a bucket in your home to store the water, you have a capacitor to store the charge. Understood? Okay? Now, why do we need to store a charge? Because isolated charges are very unstable. It can immediately get neutralized. Alright? Now if you have to, let us say, create a charge and store it, what immediately comes in your mind, like how should we do it? Suppose there is a charge, this pen has a charge, how should I store the charge? Because if I touch it, it will be gone. How should I store the charge? Insulated this thing, or in a container, it should be hanging in air, something like that. Or can I give, suppose if I have a metal piece, if I provide this a charge, what will happen to charge? It will distribute on the surface. Yes or no? It will distribute on the surface. So is this a proper way to store the charge? Whatever is the charge on the pen, I will somehow distribute that charge on this metal piece. Will it be stored then? Is this safe to store like this? Why? Because if something gets touched, if you touch it, it will be gone. So it is not a proper way to store a charge. Okay? It's like you are storing water on a plate. Plate tilts little bit, water falls. Okay? So you need a proper device to store the charge. So, what it should be? What do you think? It should be a device which holds the charge without even touching it. You're getting my point? So the way we store the charge is this. You have two metal pieces. What? What do you say?
What?
You put a hole.
No, you take some other materials and more charge several
ones. I take a material which has more charge plus Q, huh? So what? If some object touches this charge is gone. If some object touches this, even this charge is gone. Fine? You need to preserve the charge. How should you preserve the charge? That is what the question is. Okay? It should not be like if I just touch it, it will be gone. Fine? So the way you preserve the charge is like this. You have two metallic pieces. two metallic pieces, okay? One of the metallic pieces you give positive charge and the other one you give negative charge. Okay? Equal and opposite charges. Now, will these positive and negative charges, they feel the force of attraction or not? They're like, they're holding on to each other. Okay? Even if you not touch from here, charges will not go. Okay? So this is a proper way to store the charge. Probably the simplest one of all. You have two metallic pieces separated. There should be an insulator between them. It should not be a conductor. You should not join them with a wire. If you join them, everything neutralizes. Okay? There should be insulator between the metal piece 1 and metal piece 2. Okay? So, write down capacitor. Capacitor has two metallic surfaces separated by an insulator. Separated by an insulator. Two metallic objects or metallic surfaces separated by an insulator is the capacitor. Okay? Now, insulator need not be like perfect insulator where even the electrons are not moving or distorting. It can be any dielectric also. Fine? Insulator or slash dielectric you can write. Two metallic surfaces separated by insulator slash dielectric. Understood? No doubt? Okay? This is capacitor. Why I have brought it? Suppose you have this capacitor, positive charge and negative charge. Now, can I say that the amount of positive charge over here represents what is this metallic object's potential? V1. Yes or no?
Yes.
And this entire metallic object will be at the same potential or not?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Entire metal always at the same potential. Okay? Fine. And this one, the amount of charge over here represents the potential over there. Okay? Understood? Now, can I say that the charge over here, let's say charge over here is plus Q and over here is minus Q. The charges stored is proportional to the potential difference. Q is proportional to V1 minus V2. Can I say that? Fine. Okay? Right? And how do you create potential difference? Creating potential difference is very easy. You can just connect a battery like this. 10 volt battery if you connect. What is the potential difference? V1 minus V2 will become 10 volt. Charges will be stored automatically. Fine. Okay? More powerful battery if you apply over here, more charges will be getting stored here. Fine? And once the charges are stored, if you open the switch, what will happen to the charge? It will stay like that. It's like you open the tap of water, when the bucket is filled, you close the tap, water stays inside the bucket. Same thing over here. Fine? Now, tell me, if I have, let's say, more charge for lesser, let me call this V1 minus V2 as delta V, for lesser delta V, okay? If I have less delta V, but charge stored is more, okay? Then the capacity to store charge of the capacitor is more or less. For lesser potential difference, it has more charge. Capacity is more because what are you supplying? You are supplying potential difference. Right? Let's say your capacity to supply potential difference is 100 volt. You cannot supply more than 100 volts potential difference. Fine? So, let's say for 1 volt, if you can have, let's say, 1 coulomb of charge, for 100 volt, you can have 100 coulomb of charge. So charge storage can go up to 100 coulomb. Fine. But if for 1 volt you can only store, let us say, 0.1 coulomb of charge, for 100 volt you can store up to 10 coulomb. Right? So if your charge is more for lesser delta V, the capacity to store charge is more. Fine. So if I have to find out what is the capacity of a capacitor, if I have to quantify it, how will I quantify it? I will say amount of charge stored divided by potential difference. For one potential, 1 volt, how much charge is stored is the capacity of the capacitor. Is that reasonable? Right? This is exactly how it is defined. This is called capacitance and it is represented as C. Okay? Usually we don't write delta V as potential difference, we just write V. Okay? So I can say that Q is equal to capacitance times C. Okay, so we already knew that Q was proportional to V. So basically C is the constant of proportionality between Q and V. Understood? It is like, you remember what is the resistance? Resistance or constant proportionality between voltage and current. Similarly, capacitance is a constant of proportionality between charge and potential difference between the plates or between the two metals. Understood? No doubt, right? Okay? So, now it is very important to understand what will be the capacity of different types of capacitors. Okay? It's like finding capacity of different buckets of water. On what parameter the capacity of a bucket depends on? Does it depend on what is the material of the bucket? No. Dimension, geometry. Even the capacitance also depends on the geometry and nothing else. Fine. So let us try to find out the capacitance of different types of capacitors. Fine. Typically there are three kinds of capacitors that are popular. That are parallel plate capacitor, cylindrical capacitor and spherical capacitor. Fine. So one by one, let us try to find the capacitance of these. Any doubts till now? Okay. What? It is not material. But material of the capacitor, it doesn't depend on. Okay? It doesn't depend on material of capacitor. But between the plate, if you put dielectric, it depends on that. What you put between the plates or between the two surfaces, it depends on that. Okay? Okay. Achha, by the way, have you ever seen capacitors in your real life?
Yes.
Where?
Fans.
Fans have a capacitor. Why do we need capacitor? Usually why we need it?
We need to discharge a lot of charge, like very quickly. A lot of current, small amount.
Okay, well, why do you have a bucket of water at your home? What is the purpose of that?
To either store
and use it later. Why you don't get water supply regularly? Suppose you have 24 hours of supply, you will not have buckets. What is the need of
supply? Small rate. You can take
exactly. That is the point. You want to increase the rate of flow. Okay. When you store the water in bucket, the rate at which you can pour water can be controlled. You can take at times entire bucket and pour it like that. Right, people do it. But then don't waste a lot of water. Bangalore has used lesser. Okay, anyways. So similarly, capacitors. Capacitors also, suppose you need lot of supply of charge at a very quick time. The supply voltage is not enough to create that much of charge supply or create that much of current. Fine. Why you need such huge amount of charge supply? For various purposes. Have you seen those defibrillators where you put on the chest and right? So there you first charge the capacitor. The capacitor has a dielectric layer. It had a paste. When the doctor does like this, The plates are not actually touching. In between there is an insulator layer of this thing. So the potential difference gets created. When you come closer, more potential difference. It does like this and then put it on the chest, discharges, charges gone, then again charges, discharges. Okay? That is one to save life. You can use it to kill also, same thing. Somebody is healthy, you might will come here. Okay, and then
camera flash
is also one. Okay, and
starting the fan.
Suppose starting the fan requires huge amount of potential difference or very large current. So you have a capacitor. Okay, start of the tube light also in earlier days has a capacitor. Okay, inside in your television, in your radio, in a mobile phone, in televisions, everywhere there are capacitors. Have you ever opened any electronic device?
Yes.
If not, then go home and open your television. Okay. So you'll have this kind of device. This. Have you ever seen a brown sort of this thing, which is planar this thing?
Yeah.
You've seen it. And then this is cylindrical capacitor. This is spherical capacitor. Cylindrical capacitor. Parallel plate capacitor. Two plates are like this. And have you seen in the earlier times the radios? I don't know whether you've seen it. There is a knob. If you rotate the knob, this moves up and down. When you rotate the knob, the plates of the capacitor, they come close or they go far from each other. So the capacitance, the value of that changes, and because of that, you can catch different frequencies. Okay? And to tell you frankly, there are much more wider uses than just storing the charge. Okay? The proper usage of capacitor happens in alternating current. It acts like a shock absorber. Just like a spring acts a shock absorber of mechanical impulse. It will absorb the shock. Okay. Similarly, sudden increase in current and sudden increase of voltage, capacitor doesn't like it. Capacitor will oppose that. Okay? A capacitor can be like a shock absorber.
Okay? It's even used in timer circuits.
There is various things, there is no limit up to which you can use it. Okay? When you take electronics in your engineering, you will understand the importance of the capacitor. There is one more thing, inductor, that will be learning in alternating current. Okay, but coming back to our routine stuff, we need to first understand the basics of capacitor, then we need to worry about various other application. Otherwise, our knowledge will become surface level only and it will be useless. Right? Okay, so first is parallel plate capacitor. As the name suggests, we have two metallic plates which are parallel to each other in parallel plate capacitor. Okay? It goes like this. This plate and that plate. Let's say it is separated by a distance of D. Okay? How this plate is arranged? Where the plate? It is going inside the board. You're not able to see it. They're like this. The two plates. Okay? They will have area. So let's say area is A. Area is A. Fine. Now, the plates, do they need to be, let's say, a square plate or a rectangular plate?
It can be anything.
It can be anything. As long as they are plates. They should entirely lie on one plane only. The shape could be anything. Okay? Suppose you have this, then you need to just consider this much area of the plate. This and this useless. Okay? The portion which is overlapping, you need to consider that area. Okay? Okay, so we need to find the capacitance of this. Okay, how do we find capacitance of this? We know that charge divided by voltage is capacitance. We know this. Okay, so how do we find that there is no charge over here? What should I do?
Connect the battery.
Assume there is a charge. It is like this. Suppose you have a bucket. Tank. I keep on using bucket, but then that is where you understand best. You have a bucket. Suppose you want to find the capacity of the bucket. You have 1 liter of water. What you do? You pour 1 liter and find out what is the difference. What is the height? Okay. Then you know that 1 liter you have poured and the rising height is lesser, so capacity of bucket will be more. Right? Similarly here, you give the charge and find out what is the potential difference in terms of charge. And then Q divided by V, the capacitance. Understood? Right? So we'll give plus Q charge to the upper plate. Let's say plus Q is given to the upper plate. And let's say minus Q, will the this plate will have minus Q charge then? If this plate is plus Q, will this have minus Q?
Yeah.
It should have. Why? Why? Because if you take a Gaussian surface like this, upper surface passes through metal, lower surface passing through metal, and electric field is like this over here, the flux should be zero. Electric field is zero when this surface passes through the metal. This surface passes through the metal, zero electric field, and electric field is perpendicular to this surface. So the flux through this closed enclosure is zero. Charge inflow should be zero. So if upper plate has plus Q charge, lower plate should have minus Q. That's like thumb rule. Okay? But then suppose you just gave plus Q charge to this, nothing to the lower plate, then what will happen? Minus Q will go to the upper surface and plus Q will come out to the outer surface. It will be neutral only, but I am talking about only these two surfaces, not this surface. Understood? This is outside the capacitor. Whatever happens here is outside the capacitor. I am concerned only about this surface and that surface, nothing else. So the water outside the bucket is not counted. Fine? Only water inside the bucket is counted. So similarly over here, charge inside the capacitor is counted. Anyways, now suppose this is the scenario. You have given plus Q charge and minus Q over here. Find out the potential difference in terms of Q between this plate and that plate. Try doing it. Don't confuse potential due to a point charge with potential due to a surface charge. Okay. It is easier to find electric fields, yes or no? Because of the Gauss law. Okay? And there is a relation between electric field and the potential. E dot dr integral is potential difference. Okay? So, we every time we find out electric field first and then find the potential difference. Okay? Now, do it. Just shows that this will be higher potential, this will be lower potential. So this minus that will be negative. It just shows which one is higher. I am just considering a magnitude of potential difference. I am ignoring it because capacity can be negative. If it is negative, say that you are storing negative charge. So it has no.
So now because of cold down, cells
have you derived this for, if you place a dielectric constant case, derived from star. Electric field will become E by K according to the definition of dielectric constant. Are you getting this? Sigma by epsilon naught. With dielectric, what will be the electric field? Sigma by K epsilon naught. This is the electric field, right? Sigma is what? Q by A. So this is K epsilon naught A. This is electric field. So potential difference will be what? Q into D divided by K epsilon naught A. Same process. So Q divided by V becomes K epsilon naught A by D. Fine. So from that derivation also you get the same thing. Alright? So your capacitance becomes K times the earlier capacitance if dielectric constant K is inserted between the plates. Understood? Fine? No doubts? Okay. Let's do an numerical. This is from your solved exercises in NCERT. Your solved exercises, by the way, are up to mains level. Unsolved ones are school level, but unsolved ones are paper. Suppose you